Father, we come before you. Lord, we just want to say that we love you. We appreciate you, Lord. We appreciate the message you have passed already this morning. That no matter what, you favor us. No matter what, you have us on your mind. And like we learned of you last week, that you are working behind the scenes. Father, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for a new day. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for that which you have prepared for us. I decree and declare, Lord, by your power, by the name of Jesus, by the blood of the Lamb, that today there will be revelation. There will be revelation. There will be light. There will be instruction. There will be clear instruction in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you for your power that is present. Thank you for always honoring us at Joshuaville. We give you all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let me first of all say that I didn't plan to wear red. It's not that I'm doing the love thing, wearing red. I was going to wear black and white, but because of the fast, it was like a sack on me. So I just managed this one by holding a bit. Praise the name of the Lord. Joshuaville, we're so blessed. How many of you agree that we are so blessed? I don't regret the day that God sent me to this Joshuaville. From the beginning of this year, in fact, from last year, what God has been doing with us, let's just give him a round of applause. Lord, we appreciate you. We do not take it for granted. You have been good to us. God has been giving us instruction. He has been encouraging us. He has been making it impossible for you not to be encouraged this year, somehow or the other. And that will continue this morning in Jesus' name. You guys should know by now, I always need water. Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, so this morning we're talking about the pursuit of love. And someone asked me earlier on during the week and said, which love are you talking about? Are you talking about agape? Or, well, the person didn't say philios or eros or whatever, but I understood what the person was talking about. Now, it is the month of love all over the world. The world celebrates love in whatever context it is that they understand it. But in Joshuaville, we're going to take the opportunity to talk about it from God's point of view. Now, we have said that this year we are pursuing. God has given us the charge. He said that we should what? Pursue, overtake, recover. Now, I really need water. Just bring it anyhow. This is disgraceful. Without a glass, bring it. Sorry, I don't mean to make you laugh or anything like that. Thank you. Yeah, much better. Okay. Yeah, so this morning we're talking about the pursuit of love. And I'll just read this scripture. It says, 1 John 4:8. It says, he that loveth not, knoweth not God, for God is what? Love. If you say you are pursuing God, we can actually say you are pursuing what? Love. If the word of God says that God is love. But before I go on, I just want us to read this scripture. Can we open or put it up? Matthew 25. I'm going to read very fast, 1 to 13. I don't have it here, so I need you to bring it up and flow with me, please. We are all very familiar with this story. It says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 of them foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels and their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him." Go on. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, "Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out." But the wise answered, saying, "Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage. Let's just end it there. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, we've been saying, pursue, pursue, pursue. I just want to liken the pursuit with preparation. What we see in this scripture is preparation meeting opportunity. Everybody was given the opportunity. All 10 virgins were given the opportunity. The bridegroom was going to come, and whosoever was going to be there would have the access to the marriage. And in the same vein, we can say this year, God has given us all the opportunity. He has caused so many prophecies to go forth. Because we're in the month of love, we're talking about love. He has said that, look, there will be many marriages, for instance. He said that there will be pleasant surprises. He said that we're going to recover all. There will be restoration. Now, just like in the story, it's for everybody. Everybody, every single one of us have the opportunity. Before I go on, let me just say something quickly. I have in my hand 7,000 naira. And at some point during this service, I'm going to just wave it out like this. And whosoever picks it up first can have it. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. You know what? Some people, that's the end of the service. But please, word and sound, help us get CDs, because some people are not going to hear from now on. They're just going to be targeting 7,000 naira. Praise the name of the Lord. Now, when I said that, once I lift up my hand and give and stretch out the money, whosoever gets it first will actually have it. How many of you believe me? Sincerely, you believed me. I believe me. I don't used to lie, especially not in church. Pray, and on the altar. Praise the name of the Lord. Yeah? So, we all believe. Do you know why you believe? Because you have looked at me, and you have decided that surely 7K... it's not my problem. Glory be to God. And it will never be my problem in Jesus' name. So it's something you see me able to do easily. Now we need to begin to believe God. God has power. He controls all things. Look, someone that did not have any man friend today can within, he'll just speed everything up. Pa, 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 pa. Before you know it, they say, "Here comes the bridegroom." Yes, that's how God works. Today you are crying, and the next thing, he wipes it away. I was so happy when Moses started singing, "I have confidence in you." Look, you guys have confidence in me that I'll give 7,000 naira. How about confidence in God that he will do the things that he said he will do? And you know what? Thank you, Pastor T. Thank you, everybody that allowed me to have to preach today. Because while I was preparing, I really started seeing that, oh my God, oh my God. I've not been believing God all the time. Today, I'm very strong. Tomorrow, I'm like, But guess what? Like the 5 virgins, the one that had oil inside their, what's it called? Their lamps. They were always confident. They knew that, surely this door, it was going to open. And they were not going to miss it. Now, I need you to be that confident. How confident you are that I will give you this money. God has given the prophecy. He has said it. He has said it, and he will surely bring it to pass. So, I don't want us to cry anymore. I know it's hard. I know it sounds as if I'm just saying, I'm not just saying it. I have made up my mind that I will not cry anymore. Thank you. I've made up my mind that no more crying, no more doubting today. And then tomorrow, because they are preaching, I'll say, yes, yes, yes. Then when I get home, I'll go and cry again. It means that I'm saying that, just like anybody here will be saying, a lie, as a tea, 7,000, she can't give it. That's what we are saying when we are doubting God. The Bible says, hope deferred makes the heart sick. But when the tree comes, hey, when the desire comes, it's like a tree of life. Look, let me tell you, yes, some things are being delayed, but they are coming. Praise the name of the Lord. They are surely coming. Now, let me give you an example and a testimony. I was just thinking this morning that, you know, we put names in there. Please, if you have testimonies from this name, whenever we're telling testimony, come and tell so other people will be encouraged. Now, I remember very long time ago, in my house, we started doing it as well. Before I got married, we used to pray every 9:30. And so we also had a bowl like that, that will put names of people who we want to give, that we want them to give their life to Christ. And I put the name of one of my uncles who was a Muslim. And we prayed for years and nothing happened. I mean, I got married, I left the house, that pot is still there, you know. And then all of a sudden, this is like probably like almost maybe 7 years later, my mom just calls me and says, guess what, Uncle Taji has given his life to Christ. And the whole of my family, we started thanking him. Praise the name of the Lord. I just want you to know that, look, God is hearing. He's not a God that doesn't answer. He answers. If he has said that he's doing these things this year, he will do them. But like the five virgins, you have to be in a place where you are prepared. And whenever they come to preach to us and they say, you know what, you have to read the word, you have to pray, you have to do this, it is the preparation. We have said that this year is the year of the Holy Ghost. The oil in their lamps can be likened to the Holy Ghost. It is that, look, God wants you to be ready so that once the opportunity comes, bam, you're ready. I went for a program recently. I wanted to meet a woman of God that I've been desiring to meet. And when I went there, I went with a purpose that I wanted to be imparted that day. I didn't know how it was going to happen. And when I walked into the place, first of all, the same lady that walked me into a fellowship a long time ago that made me feel so welcomed, she just came and she said, oh, follow me. And she took me right to the front. I wasn't able to sit on the first row, but I sat on the second row. And because I knew, this is where we say shame, shame, devil. Praise the name of the Lord. Because I knew that, look, any moment this woman is going to call for the impartation or whatever. So I was prepared. Let me tell you how I prepared. I had a chair in front of me. There was nobody sitting on the chair. So I had already planned it that if this woman should just say anything about an impartation or whatever, I would just move this chair, move it like this, and I fly to the front. I was ready. So first of all, someone is laughing because she was there with me. I was laughing because, first of all, she called for, you know, some people. And the people she called, they were not the one that me I was talking about. But I was still prepared, Shada, if this woman, she should just do this. The next thing, she just said, there's someone here that you are supposed to shake my hand. Before she finished it, I just pushed that chair, boom, boom, and I was in front. I'm sure even the people around me would have wondered, eh. And I just took that hand and I had my impartation. Praise the name of the Lord. The point I'm making is that, first of all, the first stage is that you need to believe God. And then you prepare, just like the five virgins. You need to be in the right place. How many of you know that if I was at the back of the church of that program, it might have been a bit more difficult? There's positioning. God helps us to position ourselves for what he wants to do in our lives. And that's why you have to be attentive. The five virgins, they were attentive. They were not distracted. They made sure they always had oil in their lamp. They were all prayed up. You've been saying, oh, I want to get married this year. I want to do this. I want to do that. I want pleasant or I want big things in my business. But are you in a place, you know? Another thing that positions you is faith, you know? If you seriously believe God, it is like being in the right place at the right time. And God will surely meet you in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's give the Lord a round of applause for Moses. See, he's counting his millions. That 7,000, it will become $7 billion in your hand. Praise the name of the Lord. So, please, I hope you have all that I've said so far from Moses, because he didn't hear, he has been waiting. Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, I'll just move on very quickly. Because I just wanted to lay that foundation so that when we are talking today, you will understand that what we're just doing is positioning ourselves, preparing ourselves so that we will be in the right place at the right time, and that opportunity that he has spoken concerning this year will not pass us by in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, let's open our Bibles to Romans 8, verse 32. Romans 8, 32. Can you put it up for me, please? It says, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? The problem is that sometimes we say, I don't deserve it. The virgins, nobody asks whether they deserve it or not. God had just made the opportunity available, bam. Was it about whether they deserved it or not? Was there any condition? There was no condition. It was just a matter of, this opportunity is available for everybody. It's up to you to be prepared when it comes. Praise the name of the Lord. And for you to believe, he said, I gave my son for you. Jesus Christ gave his life for us. So what is money? What is it that we're looking for, please, that he will not give us? And we need to come to that realization so that we will stop, you know, we will stop thinking that, oh, it's not going to happen. I'm never going to get married. My marriage is never going to be good again. No hope. Crying. How many of us cry at night? Sincere. You cry. Yes. You cry. Please, don't cry again. Don't cry again. See, please, can you put the scripture up again? He said that, shall he not with him also freely? I just gave him freely. Freely. No conditions attached. Freely. You don't have to deserve it. The enemy will tell you that you, that you are not even serious. How will you get anything? It's not for you. He will deceive you. And that's what he does. He deceives us just so that we won't have faith. And indeed, we'll miss what we're supposed to get. So this morning, I'm supposed to talk about the pursuit of love, the pursuit of God in the context of marriage. But I found out that many of us, we don't really understand marriage. And I dare say that I'm not sure I really understood it when I got married. But this morning, we've prayed that let there be light. You see, when you even understand marriage, you will see that it is not something you will be begging God for. No! You won't need to say, God, please, I want to get married. Because his plan is that you get married. Do you understand? He is the owner of the idea. He is the one that planned it, that this is what I will do with marriage. Do you understand? So it's not like we compartmentalize our lives. We put spiritual separate. Then we say marriage. Marriage is like you trying to sort yourself out while the spiritual things are ongoing. Do you understand? So a lot of times, we're very good spiritually. We can believe God for anything. But when it comes to marriage, we think we have to sort it out by ourselves. We think we have to be beautiful enough For the guys, you think you have to have money. If they invite you for a single thing, lie, you won't come. You know, all I need is money. Money. Look, all this one is not my problem. If I just have money, whether I will not marry now, you see. Yes! That's how we see it. But the truth is that marriage is at the center of God's mind. Let's open the scripture. Pastor Lala, I was praying that you would come to church there. You came. So that you'd be saying, yeah, come on. Okay. Let's open our Bible. The first thing I want us, I'm going to share five fundamental truths about marriage. Number one, marriage is God's idea. If something is God's idea, why do I think I have to sort myself out? I'm going to read Malachi 2 verse 15 in the Message version. It says, can you put it up? Good. God, not you. Tell your neighbor, God, not you, made marriage. His spirit inhabits even the smallest details of marriage. Did you know this before? I didn't know. His spirit inhabits even the smallest details of marriage. And what does he want from marriage? He says he wants children of God. He wants godly seed. That's what. So guard the spirit of marriage within you. Don't cheat on your spouse. Praise the name of the Lord. This scripture is telling us that God, marriage is God's idea. The second point is also in this scripture, which is that God, marriage is God's number one strategy for evangelism. Did you see what he said he wants? He said he wants what? Godly seed. I don't know how many of us saw the video where they'll be showing Islam and how they're giving birth and multiplying. Yes, if you've seen the video, let me see, you've seen the video. That is the strategy God had for Christianity. That look, like Abraham, we read it in Open Heavens this morning, that he commanded his children and his entire household after God. God's plan is that godly man will meet godly woman, they will give birth to godly children, children they will teach. Before you know it, we now have, if they have five children, we now have five God's generals. Those ones too will marry. Before we know it, all over the place, we have Christians. Praise the name of the Lord. It is part of God's plan. Let me also give you another scripture that backs that up. The fact that it is God's number one strategy for evangelism. Okay, I can't find it at the moment. I'll come back to it. But we've noted that one, marriage is God's idea. Two, marriage is God's number one strategy for evangelism. Number three is that marriage is a mystery. Everybody say, marriage is a mystery. Don't try and figure it out. It doesn't really make sense like that. It's not 1 + 1 = 2. Nah. Okay. Let's open our Bibles to Ephesians 5, 31 and 32. It says, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Marriage is a great what? Mystery. Don't apply logic. A lot of times we want to apply logic. I want to marry the guy that I think fits what, you know, I like. Not necessarily. It depends on what God is planning for your life. It depends on your purpose. The scripture we read says that 1 + 1 became what? 1. So why do we try to figure it out? Why is it that we just say, the guy cheated on her now, so clearly she should leave now? Yes, that makes sense, doesn't it? But marriage does not make sense like that. It is not logic. It is a mystery. Praise the name of the Lord. All these things, as you know them, I promise you that one, they will help you when you are making a decision to marry. And if you are married already, they will help you to focus on what God's actual plan is for your marriage. I've said how many things now? Three. Now, the fourth one is that God intended marriage to reflect His image. We have already said that God is what? Love. So He intends marriage to show, and when I say love, I mean agape. Let me tell you, eros, or whatever they define it as, that's the attraction between man and woman. It cannot keep marriage together. It cannot. It is agape. It is the love of God that can bind you together. Praise the name of the Lord. So indeed, He wants it to reflect Him. And I'll show you the scripture for that. Genesis 1, 26 to 28. Genesis 1, 26 to 28, I'll read. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So God created man in His own image. In the image of God created He him. Male and female created He them. So guess what? The them that He said, if you look at verse 26, 25, when He said, "Let them have dominion," who was He talking to? The man and the woman, the male and the female. He also said, "Let us make them in our own what? Image." So the picture, the marriage unit is meant, God made it in His own image, meaning that is how God is. The way where a man and a woman come together and become one is a reflection of who God is. And He explained it further to us that what is actually happening is that the same way Christ loved the church, that He gave Himself, and then we can now come unto Him. We become one with Him. We become one in Christ, Christ in God. That is what marriage is. It's supposed to reflect. You should ask yourself, if you're married, is my marriage reflecting God? Remember, God is love. Is my marriage reflecting love, the love of God? You are considering marriage sincerely to yourself. If I marry this girl, if I marry this man, will our marriage be reflecting God? Ask yourself, because that's His purpose for marriage. He wants it to showcase Him. So it's a wonder when we do nonsense. That's what I've decided to call it in marriage. When you think you're fighting your husband, you think you're fighting your wife, but really, you're just helping Satan and his ministry, quite frankly. You're helping him do what he wants to do. Because guess what? Satan was there when God said, "Let them." It now makes me understand why Satan hates marriage so much. Because he knows that the person, the people that the mandate was given to is the marriage unit, male and female. So whatever he can do to bring them apart. I explained it before that, look, do you know why Satan makes us ill? He wants sickness, disease, because he knows that he is not legal on this earth. Satan has no power on this earth. The person, the people they gave the power to is male and female, created he them. And he said they should go and what? Have what? Dominion. He said they should go and be what? Fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth. So he's thinking, if I can divide these people, then surely they cannot do this thing that God said they should do. Praise the name of the Lord. Also, he knows that because it is man that God has given the authority, the dominion on earth, that's why he brings sickness. Because he knows that, if I can just kill him, where is his dominion? If I can just kill his body. And I explained it before to you that that's why when you're praying about sickness, it's not a matter of begging God. God has your interest. He wants you hale and hearty because that dominion he said you should have, he needs you to have it. The plan he has for you, you can only do it when you are hale and hearty. So if there is any sickness in your body, you need to begin to speak to it that, look, there is God's plan for my life, and I will fulfill it. Satan, why do you think Satan always uses people? Because he doesn't have the authority. God himself does not have the authority on earth. That's why he's always saying, I'm looking for a man. I'm looking for an intercessor. I'm looking for someone that will partner with me. Because he already gave them the dominion. So when you're praying about marriage, you are not praying, I want to be sorted out. I just want someone to hold me. No. You are praying a serious prayer. This is your life. This is the mandate that God has given you. And so it is crazy when we want to make that decision that we make it based on crazy things. Like, her hair is fine. By the time I touch it. What about, you don't know that her hair is permed. When it's due, go and touch it. I know a pastor that said that he met a woman and he just fell in love. Ah, I like this girl. Chai. So by the next day, he called his friend. Let's go and visit her. He just said that when he just saw her from far, her legs were, please, I don't mean, see, I have bow legs, thank God, so I cannot be abusing anybody's legs. But he said he saw her legs like this. He just said, that he's not doing it again, no. And that's how he ran away. Can you imagine? So look, we have to be serious. When God said, let them, no, I don't think he was. We've already said that this is our body, is our death, is death body. Is not us. Don't let your body limit you. Don't let the fact that you are not yellow, you are not black, you are not slim, you are not, it has nothing to do with the mandate God has given you. And so when you are making a decision on marriage, please don't let those things drive you. Look, when I married my husband, I know that, oh, I like that, oh, he's a fine man and all that. But honestly, when I'm sitting down and I'm thinking about my husband, I'm not thinking, he's so fine. I'm not thinking that. I'm thinking, thank God that you gave me a good husband. Ha. Thank God that he doesn't beat me. He doesn't raise his voice against me. He loves God. I can see it. He doesn't go drinking. He doesn't, you know, those are the realities. And I can see that we are going somewhere together. We always hear Pastor T say it all the time that, if he had married a certain person, whoa, most likely he won't be Pastor T. And I tell you, I have someone like that in my own life that if I had married that person, God knows that I won't be here. I might be enjoying some things, or like maybe, you know, some luxury, you know what I mean? But it's really, really, I'm already preaching past my message. Sorry. So I've mentioned, have I mentioned five? I think I've preached five, even though I've not mentioned five. So I said one, marriage is God's idea. Marriage is a mystery. God intended marriage to reflect his image, and that marriage is God's number one evangelism strategy. And that finally, the mandate, I preached it, that the mandate in Genesis 1:28 was given to a marriage unit. Praise the name of the Lord. So it is in God's interest that you get married, not because you want to sort yourself out. Not because you want someone to call your own. Because we do want someone to call our own. I remember when I was single, I used to, you know, I used to just think, because when I was younger in university, some people would say they feel one emptiness in their hearts. Me, I didn't feel empty. I was very spiritual. Ah, rebosh kalabatenebo. But some fun knows, pray yamban tole ketaya. Ah, which emptiness. But after I left school, after I left that environment, oh, how I wish I had some. Praise the name of the Lord. It's not just about you wishing you have someone. God has your interest. He's going to give everybody here their own bone of their bone, flesh of their flesh in Jesus' name. And for those of you that are married, with this understanding of marriage, I would like you to reassess your marriage. Do like a reset based on the the revelation you have today. I'm going to do the same. I'm already seeing some things. I'm already seeing that when I'm irritated at my husband and I am fighting him, it is myself I am fighting. Because they said 1 + 1 is equal to what? 1. When I should have known, because before, and I am not joking, I'm not just saying it because I'm here. Anytime I argued with my husband, I was very unhappy, I would have a headache. My head will be doing boom, boom, boom. Meanwhile, he looks so calm, so cool. Yes. Actually, it's because I'm fighting myself. When you are planning for your spouse, you say, I will show him. You will show yourself. Praise the name of the Lord. Reset. Okay, with that, with those fundamental truths, we can now say that, what is this preparation? We started by saying that we needed to be prepared. Like the 5 virgins, they were prepared. What is this preparation? You see a marriage. Thank God for faith mates. The message we got during the week, it said that the grass is always greener in someone else's field, but that the grass that is actually greener is the one that is what? Watered. So stop looking at other people's marriage and say that, how I wish I had that marriage. They are watering their own. That's why it's green. What are you putting into your own? What are you investing in your own marriage that will make it look green like that? Is it fighting, nagging, nagging, nagging? You know, men are always complaining that we are nagging. Nagging. Even when I know he's a nag, I will still nag, because I need him to know. But sometimes I just say, okay, let me not nag. And I see that life is a better place. But I'll now be arguing with myself that, so how is he going to know that I don't like this thing? I don't like this thing. I don't. I might not be nagging now, but I don't like it. Then sometimes I will give up and nag again. And sometimes I will look for a good time to. It won't be nag again, it will not be nag. Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, so very quickly, because my time is up. And by the way, my time was up before I started with you guys. So there are 3 things, 3 words of advice I want to leave you with. And I promise you that as you do it, look. Joshua will be bursting with marriage. He will be bursting with godly children. He will be bursting with all the things that God has planned for us in Jesus' name. Amen. The first one is that you have to make up your mind whether you want to play it God's way or not. It is one thing to know that, okay, now it is God's idea. But how do you want to do your own marriage? By God's way or another way? Let me tell you what makes me say this. I hear things all the time. People will complain to me that, I have to test though. Because nowadays, more and more, we are hearing that by the time you get married to the guy, nothing happening. So some women have told me that they are going to test. And so whether you like it or not, I'm going to test. Do they want to play it God's way or not? Let me read the scripture, because it is not me. Joshua 24, verse 15, please. Wake up. Okay? And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served, that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Many of us have to come to that place where we say, Mio, I am going to do it the God way. Now, let me... Yes, you will not confess that you won't do it the God way. But let me tell you how you know that you are not doing it the God way. When they call for, there's a sequel thing, you now go and wear something that when that guy sees your cleavage, whoa, he will take. Meanwhile, you pray though, you pray that Raymond Torobo Shekatana Baba. I will meet my husband today. But when you now get there, wisdom is profitable to direct. Praise the name of the Lord. It's not God's way. Men, you say that you love God, but you ask the girl, please, 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 I want to say this, and I'm not joking. Joshuaville ladies, if any guy in Joshuaville asks you to sleep with him before marriage, please come and report him. We will make an example of him. Yes. You see, they've been talking to the girls all the time. They'll say, women, you should be these women. What about the men? Are you a God man or not? Yes. Why are you asking her to sleep with you? If you claim that you are a man of God, please, let's decide, are we playing it God's way or not? And for those of us that are already married, there's something I had to correct at Connect. Have you noticed that nowadays, I even saw it in a show on TV, that they'll say, women, give him plenty of sex, so give him plenty of food, though, because his eye will go out, oh. Why is his eye going out? If he wants more sex, he should discuss it with you. If he wants more food, discuss it with you. Why is his eye going out? What is happening outside? Is God outside? Praise the name of the Lord. Let us decide, how do we want to do it? Do we want to do it God's way or not? Sometimes you say that, my daddy used to beat his my mom. So you should just be lucky that I'm not beating you. You are treating your wife badly. What a shame. Shame on you, guy. Look, like I said there, they always say women build your home. It is true. Don't tear your home down. Yes, but can I tell you that the man, as you are the head of the home, you are the one responsible for your home. You are the CEO of your home. And if there's anything wrong with the company, please, who do you go and look for? The CEO. When they ask anyone in heaven about marriage, it's going to be you, oh man of God. How did you do your home? How did you lead? Did you lead by example? Glory be to God. I bless God for my husband. My husband leads me by example. One of the first things that I always say that I learned from my husband is not to be vindictive. No matter what I do to my husband, the lovely, loving things he does for me, he will always do. No matter if I misbehaved. And doesn't that sound like God? Doesn't that sound like God's reflection? Yes! That no matter what you do, Jesus died for you already. And he said it, let's read it, Ephesians. My time is over up. Ephesians 5, 21. Let's read from 21, I'll stop when I need to. Submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and did what? Gave himself for it. Do you know that if a man gives himself for you, you would do whatever? You would do what? It will be easy to submit. It will be easy. You will say, whoa, whoa, whoa. Oh, my husband. Yes. But if he's giving you grief, the kind of grief that even Jesus does not give you. Praise the name of the Lord. My time is over. And let me just confess, when I saw Pastor T, I said, yeah. Oh, yeah, let me be going. So the first thing we said was that one is make up your mind whether you want to play it God's way or not. Secondly, is that you have to invest in marriage. Whether you are married already, whether you are about to get married, you have to invest. The story we told about how it is the tree that gets watered, that is what? Green, that flourishes, that is peaceful. Do you want your marriage to be peaceful? Invest in it. Invest, we've read it, invest love, invest respect. Women, they've told us that you should respect your husband. They've told us that, look, respect what they want. So give them what they want. See, my husband, I call him Eh. Say, you know, I don't know, who are, do you remember people you understand? Instead of saying, Kilomaje, I say, Kilemaje. I know it's agreeable why I'm saying that. Maybe it's because of age difference, but it's not just that. It's because I actually also watched my mom do the same for my dad. There was always respect for the dad of the house, for the CEO. Many of us respect our bosses more than our husbands. When your CEO comes, you say, hey, that sir, I have everything ready for you. But when your husband comes, you'll be like, he's late. You put the food and you go. You guys should be wondering, why do I have so much experience? Praise the name of the Lord. Because I know I've been there. I always have to encourage myself that, look, do it in the way that even your husband will have to say thank you. He will be embarrassed that, sir, see what this girl is still doing, even though I came back so late. Do you know that without having discussion about whether he came late, he will try to come earlier the next time, when you still treat him like a king, though he's late? It's the same principle. It's the same love principle. God, Jesus has loved us anyhow. So we should learn to love anyhow. So just to speed it up, so I would say, let's read Luke 6, 12 and 13. For those of us that want to get married, the prophecy has gone that you will get married. But look at what it says. It says, and it came to pass in those days that he went out, this is Jesus, he went out into a mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God. And when it was day, he called unto his disciples, and of them he chose 12, whom also he named apostles. So when Jesus wanted to make a big decision, he wanted to choose his disciples. He went to pray how long? All night. Many of us want to choose our spouses without prayer. Many of us, we don't even want to, we'll pray, but we don't want to hear the answer. Look, you have to have a, if God does not go with me, I will not go. You have to have that mentality. Otherwise, you'll be in trouble in marriage. You'll be in trouble. It's so easy to get into trouble in marriage. You just see that, oh my God, I've married the wrong guy. And look, you made vows. You can't come and just be saying, if there was no big deal about vows, no need to investigate a guy now. You just marry any guy, marry any girl, and if he is not what he said he would be, you dump him. Yeah. But I'll show you what it says about vows, that we make vows in front of God, in front of angels. Everybody is witnessing. You say, I will love and hold, I will cherish, I will have and hold, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer. You will say all sorts of things. Many of us don't know that when we are saying those things, you are binding yourself. They say that it's better not to make a vow than to make it and then not keep it. The Bible says that you are a fool. Do you know who a fool is? The person that said there is no God. That is what you are saying when you make a vow and you don't keep it. So you don't think it's me, or it's in Job. I can't find it at the moment, but it's in Job. When I find it, I'll read it out to you. It's in the book of Job that says that, look, if you make a vow, just make sure that you are intending to keep it. So like we said, invest. If you are not yet married, invest in prayer. I remember then I called some of my friends. We used to pray 1 hour every morning on this matter of marriage. Yes, there's no point crying. What's crying for? Pray. We've agreed that prayer is you. We've said it at the beginning that God, he does not have legal room on earth. He needs your permission to do stuff in your life. So if you don't give him that permission, even the decision to give your life, you have to allow him. You have to open the door for him to come in. So prayer is giving God permission to walk in your life. So if you keep your mouth shut, you don't pray. He loves you, but he can't do anything because he's not legal. It's only when you speak it, when you allow him, that he becomes legal. So make sure you are praying. Make sure you are praying. The five virgins we read about, they were praying. They had oil in their lamp. They were ready. You have to be ready. And I'll just round up, because clearly we can't say everything. The third thing is that for those who are not married yet, you have to marry someone you share values with. And for those who are already married, it's too late. So just remember your vows. Praise the name of the Lord. When I say share the same value with, many of us just think that, oh, Christian. I was sharing at Connect the other day that many ladies will come and meet me and say, I'll say that, does he love God? They'll say he's God-fearing. Do you know what God-fearing means? That means he believes that there's a God. Who doesn't believe that there's a God? Satan said, believe that there's a God. But does he fear God? Does he fear God enough that if God tells him that don't marry that girl, he will dump you like hot water? That is the man you should marry. That is the man that will not beat you because he's afraid of God. For men, we think we don't need any help. Does the woman fear God? Do you know that there's even abuse with women? Yes, some women will carry hot water. They will carry hot water once there's a small fight. They will throw pans. But they won't show you that or during dating. During dating, they will comb their hair nice. They will offer you, when you come and visit them in their house, they will give you dishes. Guys, be suspicious. They will give you dishes. There will be goat meat, all sorts in the dishes that you think, ah, this is a good one. But the person that knows the end from the beginning, you need to check with him. And when I say the same values, what I mean is, are you going to the same place? Value is not just that we are both Christian. What do we both value? Many of us that in Joshua, we value purpose. We value the plan of God for our lives. Don't go and marry a wishy-washy guy that doesn't value those type of things. That just wants to build a house, have children, do nothing. No, not be influential, nothing. He just thinks life is about, we make money, we send children to school. Marry someone with purpose. Someone that is going where you are going. That shares your value. Not the one that when you want to send your children to the best schools, you have to argue. Yes, you say that, we went to Savage in school. And look at me today. Yes. Praise the name of the Lord. Is that what we want? Okay, I will end here. Let's give the Lord a round of applause. So Joshuaville, I just want to encourage you again that these prophecies that have gone ahead of us, they are real. They are as real as the money that I pointed out and Moses caught. And God has pointed it out. He has thrown it out to us. He has said there will be many marriages. He said there will be pleasant surprises. For some of us, pleasant surprises, promotion. For some of us, it is that we just need a new job. You just need a new business. For some of us, it's that, look, I'm looking up to you, God, for seed. Even for seed, we now see that you don't have to beg God for a child. God planned your marriage so that you will have godly seed. It is his plan. So no begging. You just align. God, it is your plan that I will have seed in this marriage. It is your plan. It is your evangelism plans, your strategy that I will bring up children that know you. And they will do the same to generations to come. And God will understand that, child, I have not seen this faith just the way Jesus said it. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's just stand. Let's rise on our feet, please. So if you're here and there's just something you've heard today that has encouraged you to see that, look, God has me on his mind. He has marriage on his mind for me. He has a peaceful marriage on his mind for me. Yes, you can go. He has everything sorted out for me. I will not cry anymore. When you go back to your bed this evening, please don't cry. Don't cry anymore. I've made up my mind as well. I'm not going to cry anymore. Am I saying that God doesn't want to give me that thing? He wants to. So no need to cry. Instead, I encourage myself in the Lord and I thank Him and I glorify Him for that which He's done. So I'd like us to sing the song that Moses sang. I have confidence in you, Jesus.